So in this position, there is non-existence and then existence proceeded from it, or existence was risen from it, or came out from it. Non-existence became existence. When non-existence is absence of every existence, how do you get existence? In which science, scientific theories, logical theories or arguments that you can use and say, yes, it's possible? I don't see it's possible in any way, shape or form.
Well, so, and again, I don't think you can know either way, but I would say there's a sort of, again, I'm going to use it again. I'm going to say a finite time without boundary. Okay, because time is such a difficult concept to grasp. Okay, in the sense that, you know, it may be curved. It becomes meaningless to say whether or not there is a beginning. You know, I don't know how else I can.
I kind of get what you're trying.
You get what I'm. Can you put it to him in a way that like it's better
than?
What
I'm saying. Well, yeah. I think you're wrong.
Well, explain.
Thank you. Intellectual
okay, explain.
No.
Explain. You've heard him. Explain now.
I'll explain something.
Did you hear my question, though, by the way? With all respect. What was my question?
What, to him?
Yeah.
How can non-existence not exist if it doesn't exist? Some rubbish like that.
No, that wasn't my question. Sorry, with all respect. With all due respect, no, what I'm saying is, when you offer your response, it's only fair, do you not agree, that the response is in line with the question that is asked?
Yes.
Right. So the question that I asked, I will tell you what I asked. When you have non-existence, how do you get existence from non-existence?
But I'll answer that.
Thank you.
I'll put a question to you. Does death exist? Answer that.
I'm not answering anything. I'm going to ask you.
You can't answer it.
It's not about I can't answer it. You agreed with my friend here, Jacob, was it?
It's a simple question. Does death exist?
Explain. Oh, okay. Define death.
You can't define death because it doesn't exist.
Sorry. If you ask me a question, your question has certain words in the language that you're speaking with me in English. Every term must have a meaning. If it's meaningless term, then I cannot provide you any response. So when you say, does death exist? So does, I know what does mean in English language. I can pick up a dictionary on my phone and I can tell you what does mean. Does, did, do, right? Right. Death is the key point. Well, I'll come back to it later. Existence. Yes, it's a defined term. So I'm asking you simply, what do you mean by death? Would you like to qualify your term? Define it in simplest way.
The answer is no. It doesn't exist.
You see, you're not responding and engaging with me. You asked me a question for me to respond to you. Do you? Okay, it's not fair.
Yes,
for me to respond to you, I need to understand all the terms in your statement.
But he's not asking
it's
that.
He's asking death, right? Who can ever experience death?
Sorry.
It's very, very
sorry, I find it. I find it not
you
very.
You can't experience it.
I find it not very beneficial.
It's an abstract concept.
Okay. Do you find it beneficial to continue?
So I appreciate that you want to get involved. But I think if you sort of miss each other's questions, you can't really sort of gain any real benefit from it. No. But to be.
How can I answer something when your terms is quite vague? You need to explain to me what you mean by.
It's very simple.
Okay. Thank you. Death.
Doesn't exist.
Are you asking me something or are you making a statement?
Carry on. You can't experience something that doesn't exist. It's impossible. That's why we're all alive. There's only life. That's it.
Okay. Initially, you asked me a question, right?
Yes.
Right. You asked me, does death exist?
Yes.
Thank you. Qualify your term death, what it means.
Told you, it doesn't exist. It's an abstract concept.
Okay.
But would you say it's a word that we use to describe the point from which we as humans move from existence into non-existence, or if you're religious, then from this existence into some other plane of existence. That's, I would say it's just a word to describe a change of state. Did that satisfy you?
Yeah, a little bit.
Right.
That's semantics, isn't it?
Well, it's everything's semantics. Yeah.
The reality is, all I'm saying, I'll repeat it over and over again. And nobody understands this. Very few people. Death doesn't exist.
I agree with you.
You're not going to experience something that's not there. It's absolutely impossible.
So basically, you're asking me. So you're asking me this question. So you're asking me this question. Okay. Tell me when you finish.
Yes.
Okay. So you asked me a question about something that doesn't exist. Does something doesn't exist exist?
You're supporting your cause, by the way.
Please. Your question to me is for me to answer. Something that doesn't exist, does it exist?
Doesn't make sense.
Yeah? That's what you're asking me.
Something that doesn't exist, yeah. I'll agree with that.
Yeah, so you're saying, no. You're saying something doesn't exist, does it exist? Okay, let me tell you why your question is not a question, it's a rhetorical statement. To be a question, a statement to qualify into a question, sorry, I have to give you this information. It has to have two essential properties. Number one, it has to have potential answers, and it must be free from internal contradiction. For example, if I ask you and you, how many legs does the sun walk upon, two or three?
You can answer
now,
that.
Wait. So, is my statement a question? I'm asking like, I'm framing it like a question, and I'm even giving you options. Two or three legs does the sun walk upon?
It's a question. It's a silly question.
No, it's not a question. It's not a question. The reason why it's not a question is this. I'll tell you why it's not a question. Because a question must be free from internal contradiction. The sun does not have legs. I cannot then ask, how many legs does it walk upon, two or three? When we affirm the sun doesn't have legs. It's a meaningless rhetoric.
A nonsensical question might as well be not a question, I think, basically. Yeah. You can say
it's a rhetorical statement.
Yeah, sure.
So when you ask me a rhetorical statement, you actually haven't asked me a question to answer. So I am not obliged to answer anything because there was no question asked. So come back to you, my friend, Jacob.
Yes. I can't remember where we left off.
Talking about how do non-existence come into existence or become existence?
Right.
In your model.
Yes, I forgot what I was speaking about, but essentially I think I'm trying to explain that time may be shaped as such that it's finite but without boundary, which means you don't need to ask where did existence begin, but you also don't need to ask the question of is it infinite or not.
You're going in a different way of solving the equation. Remember, when you have an equation, you can either way start, right, from each other and see whether it works.
Yeah.
I'm asking you
it
to
might
start.
Be an absurd equation.
No, I'm asking you to start from this position, non-existence.
Yeah.
Right, so you have non-existence to begin with. Non-existence. Like my wallet with no money, for example. Now, how do we get money from my wallet when there's no money? You have non-existence. How do you even get a boundaryless or infinite time? How do you even get to that point when you begin with non-existence?
Because that's a model concerning time, there may not have been non-existence to begin with.
You see, I'm finding it very strange to discuss with you, Jacob. I said there are two binary propositions in terms of our existence. One is always existence, another is not. So we are talking about the position where it's not always existence. In that position, you're jumping back to the other position. You're saying, no, that's not. That's what I'm trying to arrive at.
Okay.
When we use our mind, our intellect, our rational faculties, you will see that second alternative doesn't make sense. You have to resort back to the first alternative, meaning the only viable rational explanation, the only alternative. You keep saying, but it's that. That means the proposition of the second alternative is not an alternative. It's not something that you can even discuss or even argue for. You're actually arguing for the other one. I agree.
Don't know which I'm arguing for.
No, okay, I'm saying if you really analyze each one in turn, and we did the one which is there was non-existence to begin with. If you analyze it, you know that this is not something that any rational human being can accept. If you say that rational human being can accept that model, I would like to know rational arguments that non-existence can become existence. Which rational arguments can you use to come forward with this particular concept?
I don't know. My closest thing I can
bring your friends and philosophers and scientists in here, but start with non-existence. and then arrive at existence.
Stephen Hawking was never my friend, unfortunately. But
doesn't matter. Well, what we're saying is support us.
Right.
Remember, in the Quran, it's quite interesting. I'm going to tell you something about the Quran. In the Quran, when Allah says, when Allah challenges people to bring a chapter like under the Quran, because the Quran, we Muslims believe that it is something of a divine origin, that it cannot be a product of anything of the creation, to lend credibility and support of this divine authenticity and divine origin, right? And when the Quran, when Allah actually speaks about this, he says, those of you who are in doubt that this is not from God to his servant Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then what they have to do is produce a chapter like unto it, and if they cannot do it themselves, they can seek helpers and supporters to this job. So it's a standard principle in the Quran. When we are discussing something, if I'm not unable to, I can seek support. You can seek support from philosophical models or from models from science. Give us a rational explanation how non-existence can become existence. Get your support. I have no problem with that. Because personally, you might have exhausted all possibilities what you've read, but there might be someone that will say, look, okay, but I think, you know, this person, Feynman, or this philosopher, this is what he put forward. This is where you can ask, but you need to start with non-existence.
Okay, well, in the context of your question, I need to start from
yes.
non-existence.
Yes.
Personally, because I'm not a physicist and I'm not a philosopher and I'm not a theologian, I can't tell you.
Right.
But no one can.
So that means, think about now, in any kind of rational basis,
right.
Science has to be rational, by the way, any rational basis, we cannot see how non-existence can become existence. That's what you're telling me. You are actually...
Well, I'm not science.
It's not about science only. Rationality can be even from purely from philosophical...
What you're saying then now is you're looking at things from, you see, a natural mind. But you see, if you look on a spiritual mind, you will see things differently. You see,
I don't think that's what he...
It applies. If we look at things from our natural self, you see, a natural mind, we're limited. We have limited in our understanding. Okay, you got quite intelligent people. I'm not disrespecting them, but you see, there is something outside that, something greater. There's an understanding, you see, in a spiritual realm, like you see, that you can see, it opens us up to a different, you know, understanding of things. That's an expert from what you're saying there. When you said about that, you're looking at the natural understanding of human beings, but there is something greater.
To understand the natural world, though, naturalism is a pretty good model.
What it means. In a way, yeah, but yeah, as far as it goes, you see, you can understand things. But what I'm saying to you is, There's more to understand. You know what I mean?
Is that?
And yeah, there is. Yeah, there is.
But
you will have to experience it. Like that, when people tell you certain things, how you can come to understand it, like how to open yourself up to that.
Presumes supernaturalism. Yes. From your perspective, naturalism. So there's going to be this conflict. You have to subscribe to one of these models, and these models will essentially, by their ideological concepts, they will conflict.
By definition.
If you're a naturalist, there are no supernaturals.
But you're saying there are some supernatural
because that's your perspective.
Yeah,
okay?
Yeah.
But that's not I'm arguing.
Let me just tell you, naturalism is a perfectly reasonable position to hold, because all you can observe in your life is natural.
That's true.
So you've got no reason to believe in anything.
No, there is, because what I'm saying to you, having experienced it, you see, for myself, you see, not what someone else might tell me. Yeah, okay, I have been told certain things, but then I made the choice to you see, to search and to listen to what certain people told me, and then certain things I believe to be true, and have the experience. It opened me up to understand. You know, if I look back at my life a good many years ago when I was much younger, and I come to understand things that I didn't understand then. That's what I'm saying to you.
Understood. Let's return. It's coming. It depends on where we're coming from, right? Okay. So, essentially, from a rational perspective, from a rational standpoint, you at this very minute cannot bring something that can be justifiable, even to your own satisfaction, that non-existence can become existence.